You've given us such a great privilege by allowing us the opportunity to come together, to have fellowship, to be able to worship, to be able to sing songs of praise, and to hear from thy precious word. We count that, Lord, as a great privilege and honor. And we thank you for the day of life that you've given to us, giving us the health and the ability to be able to be here. And though some, Lord, may not be feeling very well, still you've allowed us this great opportunity. There are many, Lord, that are sick, that are suffering in their bodies, and you've heard each request that's been made known here this morning. You see those, Lord, and you know each case and each problem. You know, Lord, what each one faces, and only you are able to supply their needs. So we lift before you today every need and every request that's been made mention here today, whether it was by voice or by the uplifted hand. And we pray that by your Spirit you would move to minister to these needs. And we ask you, Father, today that as we've gathered here, that as we worship, you would receive our worship. And as we sit here to listen for thy word to be taught and explained and expounded, we ask you to open our understanding, to help us to have hearts and minds that are willing to receive the things that you have for us. Father, we realize this truly is the last days of time that we're living in. And though that's a statement, Father, that's been made by many over the years, we see it written in your word and know it to be a truth, that truly we are living in the last days. We want to be a people that's prepared and ready for that great event when you'll come to take your waiting bride. So, Father, we ask you to continue to speak to us and to reveal your word to us, to anoint your servant, Lord, as he stands to minister. And we just pray now that you take charge of this service, and may you and you alone be glorified in it. We pray for Israel and for the peace of Jerusalem. We pray for our own nation now, and may you just be glorified in this day. We ask it in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Usually just turned over to Tim at this time, but I just thinking as I stand there as we got through praying. Everybody happy today? Are you glad you're here? Was you glad when they said, let us go to the house of the Lord? Are you happy this morning? Everybody happy? Say amen. Everybody happy? Say amen. Praise the Lord for what he's done. Praise the Lord for victory won. Everybody happy? Say amen. Well, that better. Good to see you, sister. God bless your heart. I didn't see you till now.
Amen. Try to sing this little chorus. Last time I tried to sing, I get the lines mixed up, but y'all know it. Y'all just drown me out if I don't get it right.
Such joy, such unspeakable joy, such peace, an everlasting peace, such love, a pure and holy love. Spirit, have your way in me. Such joy, such unspeakable joy, such peace, an everlasting peace, such love, a pure and holy love. Spirit, have your way in me. Oh, such joy, such unspeakable joy, such peace, everlasting peace, such love, a pure and holy love. Spirit, have your way in me. Oh, such joy, unspeakable joy, such peace, everlasting peace, such love. such peace, everlasting peace, such love, enduring holy love, Spirit, have your way in me. Oh, such joy, unspeakable joy, such peace, everlasting peace, such love, pure and holy love, Spirit, have your way in me. Oh, such joy, such unspeakable joy, such peace, everlasting peace, such love, pure and holy love, Spirit, have your way in me.
Children of mine, today, as I speak to you, I say to thee, I brought you together from many places. And many of you are coming today wondering what is going to be said. And I say to you today, my children, I have ordained this hour of time. So open wide thine heart and thine ears. And I will cause thee to hear things today that will let you know. Thou art living now in the last days. You see a nation that you live in. It is sick. I say to you, my children, it is sick. And I have a remedy for it. For it is in my word, saith the Lord.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arm. What a blessed peace, this is mine, leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarm. Oh, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarm. Oh, leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near, leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarm. Oh, leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, what have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arm. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarm. Oh, leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarm. Oh, leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arm.
Amen. One more little chorus. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, you've been so good, you've been so good to me. You've been a doctor, You've been a lawyer, been a heart fixer and a mind regulator, made a way. Healed the sick, the lame to walk, even made the dumb to talk. Oh yes, I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. You've been so good. You've been so good to me. You've been a doctor, been a lawyer, been a heart fixer and a mind regulator, made a way. Healed the sick, the lame to walk, even made the dumb to talk. Oh yes, I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. You've been so good. You've been so good to me. You've been a doctor. You've been a lawyer. You've been a heart fixer and a mind regulator, made a way. Healed the sick, the lame to walk, even made the dumb to talk. Oh yes, I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You've been so good. You've been so good to me. You've been a doctor. You've been a lawyer. You've been a heart fixer and a mind regulator, made a way. Healed the sick, the lame to walk, even made the dumb to talk. Oh yes, I thank you, Lord.
Just want to praise the Lord and thank God for his mercy and grace in my life. I want to thank him for sending a Brother Ansant and give him a safe journey here and give him a good time while he was here. I want to thank God for being in the service, and I am sure glad to be here this very day. You know, to hear the word of God and anticipate the things that are said, I'm just bubbling over.
There's a light in the window, and the table spread a splendor. And someone standing by the open door. I can see a crystal river. Oh, I must be near forever. And I've never been this home. Will you see the bright light shine? It's just about home time. And I can see my father standing at the door. This world is in a wilderness, and I'm ready for deliverance. Oh Lord, I've never been this homesick. I can see my family gathered, happy faces so familiar, and no one is old or feeble anymore. All this lonesome heart is crying, think I spread my wings for flying, and I've never been this homesick before. Will you see the bright light shine? It's just about home time. And I can see my father standing at the door. This world is in a wilderness, and I'm ready for deliverance. Oh Lord, I've never been this homesick. I can see my family gathered, happy faces so familiar, and no one is old or feeble anymore. All this lonesome heart is crying, think I spread my wings for flying, and I've never been this homesick before. Will you see the bright light shine? It's just about home time, and I can see my Father standing at the door. This world is in a wilderness, and I'm ready for deliverance. Oh Lord, I've never been this homesick before. Will you see the bright light shine? It's just about home time, and I can see my Father standing at the door. This world is in a wilderness, and I'm ready for deliverance. Oh Lord, I've never been this homesick before.
Amen. And Sister Susie and Sister Mont, Sister James, y'all get ready next.
This old house of clay shall die, but my soul is gonna live on. My soul is gonna live on. My soul is gonna live on. This old house of clay shall die, but my soul is gonna live on. I know my soul, oh yes, is gonna live on. You can kill my body, but not my soul, 'cause brother, I'm gonna live on. Oh yes, I'm gonna live on, you know I'm gonna live on. You can kill my body but not my soul, 'cause brother, I'm gonna live on. I know my soul, oh yes, is gonna live on. Well, you can embalm my body but not my soul, 'cause brother, I'm gonna live on. Oh yes, I'm gonna live on, you know I'm gonna live on. Can't embalm my body but not my soul, 'cause brother, I'm gonna live on. I'm singing my soul, oh yes, is gonna live on. Oh, when I'm dying, don't you weep for me, 'cause brother, I'm gonna live on. Oh yes, I'm gonna live on, and then I'm gonna live on. When I'm dying, don't you weep for me, 'cause brother, I'm gonna live on. Forever my soul, oh yes, is gonna live on. When the trumpet sounds and we leave this ground, then we're gonna live on. Oh yes, we're gonna live on. Forever we're gonna live on. When the trumpet sounds and we leave this ground, right then we're gonna live on. Forever our souls, oh yes, are gonna live on. When the trumpet sounds and we leave this ground, then we're gonna live on. Oh yes, we're gonna live on. Forever we're gonna live on. When the trumpet sounds and we leave this ground, right then we're gonna live on. Forever our souls, oh yes, are gonna live on. Forever our souls, oh yes. Forever our souls, oh yes. Forever our souls, oh yes, are gonna live on.
I'm happy and thankful to be here this morning, and I'm thankful God is so good. He's brought my mother through it again. I checked her blood sugar this morning and her blood pressure, and it was normal. And I thank the Lord. Thou art worthy. Thou art worthy. Thou art worthy, O Lord. Thou art worthy to receive glory, glory and honor and power, for Thou hast created, have all things created, for Thou hast created all things, and for Thy pleasure they are created. Thou worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for Thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by Thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, and hath made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. And I beheld and I heard the voice of many angels around about the throne and the beast and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000s and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing." And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth and such as it in the sea and all that are in them heard I saying, "Blessing and honor and glory and power be unto Him that sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb that liveth forever and ever." And the four beasts said, "Amen." And the 24 elders fell down and worshiped Him that liveth forever and ever.
Maybe see you. Carmen David.
Remember us in prayer. We practiced one time, but the song was a blessing to both of us. The chords are kind of hard, so good luck. When the valley is deep, when the mountain is the body is weary, when we stumble and fall, when the choices are hard, when we're battered and scarred, when we've spent our resources, when
in Jesus' name. help me to stand when I am weak, and help me to believe when I cannot see that it's your guiding hand that's leading me. When I am weak and down on my knees, Lord, help me to stand. Lord, help me to stand when I am weak, and help me to believe when I cannot see that it's your guiding hand that's leading me. When I am weak and down on my knees, Lord, help me to stand. Lord, help me to stand. That it's your guiding hand that's leading me. When I am weak and down on my knees, Lord, help me to stand. Lord, help me to
sang this little chorus down in West Virginia. And I kind of changed the last line a little bit. It was, Lord, take my hand and guide my steps. Help my doubts and unbelief. And so, Lord, I need you and you alone. And I know I can't do anything without him. Need him for all things. He's our very existence. But, you know, I just felt that I needed to change that a little bit because I need my brothers and sisters too. So we're going to change that last line a little bit to just lead me on. Help my doubts and unbelief. So like I said down there, I believe God can raise the dead. I believe he can heal cancer. I believe he can do all things. Too many times we see little situations that we think, why ain't God doing something about this? And why is this going on? But he's in control of all things. You believe that today? Amen. Lord, take my hand and guide my steps. Help my doubt and unbelief. For I am weak, but you are strong. Lord, I need you.
to lead me on. Lord, take my hand and guide my steps. Help my doubt and unbelief, for I am weak, but you are strong. Lord, I need you to lead me on. Lord, take my hand and guide my steps. Help my doubt and unbelief, for I am weak, but you are strong. Lord, I need you to lead me on. Lord, take my hand and guide my steps. Help my doubt and unbelief, for I am weak, but you are strong. Lord, I need you to lead me on.
Hallelujah. Yes.
Lead me, Lord, I will follow. Lead
We used to sing that song, that Hallelujah Chorus, as her sister was singing there, Sister Mayfield. Usually would always cut in with singing in the spirit before it was over with. You know, she's waiting now. She's waiting her turn for the rest to come. And I praise the Lord this morning for the memory of those that have gone on, every one of them. It's a great memory. But they're waiting. They're right there in their place waiting for the rest of us to get there, for the old body to change and new bodies and everything. So we thank the Lord this morning. I'll turn the service over to Brother Jackson.
You may be seated this morning. Thank you, Brother Allen. Want to greet each and every one of you. I would rather be here than I would be in Afghanistan. Amen. And I wouldn't rather be here than in Iran or any of the other places. Today, brothers and sisters, I'm going to ask you to turn back with me into Matthew, the 24th chapter. We're dealing with a subject. And there it is written up there, the last 100 years. There's the title. We're starting at the start of the century, 1901, as we come into the era of where the five wise and five foolish are dealt with according to the parable of Matthew 25. But when we begin to look at that, brothers and sisters, we have to realize Jesus said certain things just before he was crucified. Matthew 24, I'm going to say this slowly and carefully. Matthew 24 and 25 has specific words. If you will take from the first verse of Matthew 20, take heed that no man deceive you. That was applicable for all times. We have read Matthew 24 many times. But when you look at it very carefully, he was speaking to that generation of disciples who were Jews. Because they have just left the temple area. And on the outside, the disciples begin to just look at all of this beautiful buildings. And he told them, verily I say unto you, there's not one stone left here that shall not be left on another. They'll all come down. Leaving there and going over on the Mount of Olives. One time when we was there, we was pointed out by a guide. This is the spot where Jesus used to sit and rest as they would climb the slopes of the Mount of Olives, looking back at the city. The disciples began to come to him privately asking, when shall these things be? And then what's the sign of thy coming? And what's the end of the world? Three things. So then we begin to see him explain to the disciples. Now I'm going to say this slowly and carefully. If you will read it carefully, he was speaking these first words to that element of disciples then. He told them all about the signs of things that would come. He tells them, brothers and sisters, about Jerusalem being compassed with armies and so forth. Then when he comes on down from that, I'm pointing to the 23rd verse. From verse 15, verse 22, that was fulfilled in the days of the early disciples. I remind this to you because he's talking about two tribulation periods here. And we know there was one when Jerusalem was destroyed in that period of time. But then we're talking about another thing. You don't have to listen to me if you don't want to. But there's a day a coming when you might would to God that you had listened to somebody. Because don't forget there was another time he preached the 70 weeks of Daniel. And he preached there's exactly 7 years left. I don't care what he said when he preached the seals. Because that was his belief before he even preached the weeks of Daniel. The Seventh-day Adventists have the same thing. The Catholics have the same thing. Different writers through Christian periods have written about this. But brothers and sisters, we are living in the last generation of Christendom. If we do not begin to get our thinking straightened up, what did he say, and what did he say that puts me back in the scriptures? You can jump all over creation from book to book. But if you're not careful, brothers and sisters, you will be on the outside of the Bible running everywhere. Well, what did this mean? What did that mean? I'm not saying these things to agitate no one. But if you're going to come here and listen to me, brothers and sisters, you don't have to. But I will speak to you as kindly and nicely as I know how. This is too late in the game to travel for the next 5 or 10 years not knowing exactly what was said and what was not said. Now then, when we come then to verse 23, listen carefully to this. Then if any man shall say unto you, lo, here is Christ. Now, I'm not preaching what I said last Sunday. I'm just reminding a few people that wasn't here how to get ready when we go on this morning. This covers the era and generation of time that I have lived in when there was a messenger and a prophet to this age to straighten some things up. Then if any man shall say unto you, lo, here is Christ, or there believe it not. For there shall rise false Christ and false prophets and shall show great signs. And I have seen that period. From the time that Brother Branham started his ministry, we come all through the 50s, into the 60s. The highways across America was filled with big semis, pulling tents and chairs, going to the meetings. These men all begin to spring on the scene. As Brother Branham was used by God to spark this era. When we come to verse 25, behold, I have told you before. Wherefore, if they shall say unto you, behold, he is in the desert. Go not forth. Behold, he is in the secret chambers. Believe it not. Now, them two verses of Scripture, brothers and sisters, is applicable to our generation of time. It's Jesus saying it for our period of time. I'm looking at 1963. A lot of people wonder, well, why do you put 1963? Something happened in 1963 that the church world don't even know that it went on. And you know it. Notice what was said following that. Verse 27. For as the lightning cometh out of the east and shineth even into the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. He's not talking about his physical return over here in the end of tribulation. He's talking about his appearing for his bride. What he has said here in these 23rd and the 24th verses, and the 25th and the 6th, is to warn an element of people here in the end time. The coming of Christ will not be a secret thing propagated by an element of would-be wise people, that's the way it's going to be when he comes for his church. It's not. Now, brothers and sisters, let me say this. Through the years, there's been men in this congregation. They're not here no more. They too got the idea. We're going to have to go a certain place to get ready for the rapture. Brothers and sisters, there was one family left here. They was going to get ready to go to Jerusalem because that's where the rapture is taking place. The rapture is not going to take place in Jerusalem, nor in Indiana, nor in California. It's going to be, brothers and sisters, when your heart's ready. And keep in mind, that's not going to be a visible scene to the world in general. Because keep in mind, the rapture is for the entire body of Christ that's lived and died throughout the ages of time. Surely to God you don't think they all lived in America. Some of them lived in them Arab nations where right now they would defy you to come there. I've got the history on it. They lived and died. And I have to say this morning, the gospel has traveled from Jerusalem, then into Asia. But by the second century, brothers and sisters, it also went into the Arab world, across North Africa. In the second century, there was a Christian element in Morocco, but it's Muslim today. So when Jesus said, as the lightning shines from the east to the west, so shall it be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. For what? For his bride. It's a secret thing. Only those that are living, only those that are watching, and only those that were dead and went to the ground ready are going to see that event. Now that's the truth. Because I've got the writings, brothers and sisters, of people that want to tell you that Brother Branham's going to come back and his two brothers got an old dilapidated 50 model airplane. They're going to take him around from here and here, there. Brothers and sisters, as much as I respect the man, I don't respect these carnal ideas that some man is going to use some mechanical means to transport Brother Branham around and call for the rapture and the resurrection of the bride saints to go and collect at a certain place. Brothers and sisters, you can laugh. And you can absolutely turn against me. Go ahead. But the day will come, I'll have the last word. If God lets me live. Now then, notice what he said in verse 27. It's important that we get these verses right. We have played through time. It means this, it means this, it means... It's not a verse that means everybody's idea. Jesus meant one thing. For as the lightning, brothers and sisters, let me say this. If you read the sixth seal, and you see exactly what it says there, the coming of Jesus Christ is not here as a streak of lightning. It hangs in heaven as a sign, and the sun will be darkened, and the moon will withdraw its light, and the powers of heaven will be shaken, and the stars will fall. That's his second coming, visibly with his bride. This coming is a secret thing. Now then, so he says in the ending of the 27th verse, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. That's for his church, his bride. For wheresoever the carcass is, there will the eagles be gathered together. What a carnal expression. It sounds that way. And you don't know the number of the doctors of divinity that have looked at that and shake their heads. I don't know what he meant by that. Well, I do. It's a figurative speech. Wherever the little eagles are, and wherever the carcass of the revelation of word is at, that's where they're going to come to. That don't mean to just one spot. It means wherever there is a man of God that will fulfill this role in these last days, that sees by divine revelation the truth and the application, there's where the little eagles gather. Eagles will not gather on the carcass of something that's been run over yesterday. They only will absolutely pick on fresh killed meat. That's a figure of speech. Now then, and since we're living in the day of the fourth seal, the fourth beast that had the head, the face of the eagle, we're living under that. Therefore, if we are eagles, little eaglets, our spiritual nostrils are open for the smell of that fresh killed carcass. Now an old buzzard, he'll eat on them even if they're a week old. It stinks like everything, but not an eagle. All right. But notice verse 29. Immediately. Now he's talking about a different advent. He's talking about after the tribulation of those days. Here, the ending of the week of Daniel. Right there. Immediately. Not 6 months longer, nor 2 years. Immediately. After the tribulation of those days, shall the sun be darkened. That didn't happen, brothers and sisters, in 69 A.D. when that first episode was fulfilled. Keep that in mind. And the moon shall not give her light. And the stars shall fall from heaven. And the powers of heaven shall be shaken. No wonder then the wicked will flee to the rocks and the mountains and cry, hide us from the face of him. They don't do that back in the other one. Verse 31. And he shall send his angels. Now from verse 28, where the eagles are gathered down here, we notice now something has happened. And I'm bringing this in this morning. He shall send forth this angel with a great sound of a trumpet. And they shall gather together his elect. That's his eagles. From the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. Now, brothers and sisters, let me explain a little something. The rapture occurs somewhere right in here, in proximity around about the time the week of Daniel starts. I've heard this ever since, brothers and sisters, I first gave my heart to the Lord. And the rapture could take place any time. And that was way back here, brothers and sisters, in the late 40s. That's nonsense. The rapture cannot take place any time. There's a precise scriptural timing for it. And when Paul said what he did in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, then he goes to 2 Thessalonians. He tells you, brothers and sisters, concerning the coming of the Lord. Now he's not talking about brothers and sisters going out here in the desert somewhere. In that, brothers and sisters, he's talking about the rapture. Concerning the coming of the Lord and our, the bride, gathering together unto him, that day shall not come except there come a falling away first. Well, the King James Version, brothers and sisters, speak of the falling away, though, like it's some ecclesiastical state of apostasy. Well, that's been going on, brothers and sisters, for 45, 50 years. But when you take the Aramaic translation, it says, that day shall not come except there be open rebellion on the news. Don't mention God here. America has become a nation. From the philosophers, from the ecclesiastical big shots, to the politicians, to the news journalists. Get in a public place. And I'd like to talk to you a little bit about Jesus Christ. Shut that up. Society as a whole in America is opening and rebellion against such an idea. No wonder they don't want it in school. Apostate Christendom didn't set that in order. The devil did it. You know it. So I have to say, when you begin to see that period of time, you know it's getting close. Because even the book of Revelation in the 19th chapter, show you in the ending of the chapter where that Jesus is coming with his bride. Here is the kings of the earth and the beasts and so forth gathered together to make war against him. That's an open rebellion to try to destroy the knowledge of God completely. That reminds me of a little joke. Brother Tim McKay told me he heard this on TV the other night. A school teacher. He was an atheist. And he come down the line talking and asking each child. He says, "I am an atheist." And he come to this little 12-year-old girl and said, "What are you?" She says, "I'm a Christian." He said, "Well, if your daddy had been a moron and your mother were a moron, what would that make you?" "Make me an atheist just like you." I kind of like that kind of talking back to them. No wonder we've got a country now then, out in Oregon, Al-Qaeda cells, going through all the military maneuverings. Do you reckon they're getting ready to pull a jihad on us? They sure are. But does Washington care? They say they do. But to find out, they got to appropriate more money. And brothers and sisters, we are the most indebted nation that walks on or lives on this planet. You know it. Now then, that verse 28, I'm going to put that right there. Why would you put it there, Brother Jackson? Because when God dealt with Brother Branham like he did, in the experience that he had, and he dealt with him in such a measure to come back here and preach the breaking of the seals. I will say this morning, I sat there. That was the first divine revelation that the churches has had since the days of John. Now don't look at me like you want to say something. No man had ever preached the seals, and you know it. Because they had not been broken. I read an article the other day. Some man, a follower of Brother Branham. But they was broken to John. No, they were not broken to John. The first three chapters that John wrote concerns the church at that time. But you remember this. From chapter 4, John heard that voice from heaven, "Come up hither, and I will show you things that shall be hereafter." So when he was taken up into the spirit world, he was projected, brothers and sisters, completely in the future tense. Sure, he came back here and wrote words. But all that he saw was only in symbols. Well, if the seals had been revealed to John, brothers and sisters, he would at least wrote a little something of what they were. That's why I say in 1963 was the beginning of God in a divine way to reveal to an element of people on earth within the church age of the wise and the foolish. It started back here. Because that became the shout, or became the midnight cry, according to the parable. It was to waken the age up. And when I look back to that period of time, brothers and sisters, when them revelations of them seals began to be known, that was when God began to say, "I have prepared a table, and there's fresh meat on it." That began to be noise throughout the world. Now that prepares the stage for me to talk this morning about this time factor. We have been living in a time factor somewhere in front of us, very close. The devil through the Antichrist system is going to initiate that week. We don't know how close. But according to the signs and everything, it is getting close. But it's important, brothers and sisters, that we begin to look at this time factor. Because if we don't, then all we'll do, we'll just sit and read Scripture and sit down waiting. Well, maybe God will help us one day to understand it. Now then, I wonder this morning, listen carefully. I say them seals, as they were preached in 1963, they went all over this world in printed form. Has it changed the religious world? Not one bit. Has it? But I have to say, it has sure woke up a lot of people who want to be wise. Even in that, brothers and sisters, for some reason or other, it has left an element of people standing looking. Now then, you know and I know, the same Bible I have here this morning preaching from is what is in the Baptist pulpit this morning, in the Methodist, even in the Catholic, even in the Pentecostals. That was written there for the bride of Christ. Well, if everything that's in the religious sector, brothers and sisters, is potentially the bride of Christ, then why ain't they all reading it? That reminds me of the testimony. After Brother Branham's death, Tommy Osborne, he's my same age as me. Some friends of his told him that he ought to read these seals. It was stated that he went on a long fast and he played these tapes. When the fast was over and he'd heard these tapes, he came back and he gave them back to the person that had given them to him and he said, I want nothing to do with it. Now, brothers and sisters, the religious world is that realm of foolish people. Yet in the charismatic realm, they can shout and sing with their hands in the air and tears streaming down their cheeks. They have no divine revelation whatsoever that can begin to connect them with the soon coming of Jesus Christ. I ask the question, why? Why is it that way? It's because, brothers and sisters, they have to fulfill the foolish side. But the wise side, brothers and sisters, they can look at us. They see us for all of our faults and all of our misquotings of Brother Branham and such like. And the revelation's been concocted out of it. But I have to say, brothers and sisters, from 1963, that was the beginning of God preparing a table upon which he would absolutely present fresh meat. As I said the other night, fresh meat to these young eagles. It's not like six or seven of them just latting on a rabbit that run over on the highway. Because you know good and well, brothers and sisters, they would all be a fussing and a squawking at one another. But little eaglets in this sense, we come in an orderly fashion and we set to learn to take our portion. And with that, we then collectively begin to understand the time frame we're living in. Now this time frame, brothers and sisters, let me say this morning. This time frame will last until the rapture comes and takes the bride out of here. Well, Brother Jackson, why that long? Because in 1963, a lot of these young people wasn't even born. When I sat there and heard that man explain these things so vividly, and then after he died, a man stood in that pulpit and said, God will no longer speak by dreams or visions or gifts of the Spirit. I'll not mention the man's name. But let me say this to you. That's a first-class hypocrite. God did not call you to be a part of something that was supposed to be returned back to the faith of our fathers when Brother Branham labored through the years and emphatically stressed that the church in the end is to be a supernatural people, believing in the supernatural. Why believe in something from a prophet and come back here, brothers and sisters, and we wind up sitting on our backside like a bunch of Methodists? Now then, verse 28. I, Raymond Jackson, said, mark it, because that marks the time factor. That's when God began to set fresh meat before an element of people. And that verse has to lay here long enough. Tell every young person that's been born around this world, have been born into that era of time, heard this truth, and takes their place in the ranks of the bride of Christ. I am so glad, brothers and sisters, that since 1965, think of it. We've already come through 27 years. And look at all these young people. In a way, I'm glad Jesus didn't come back in 1965. Now, how many understand what I meant by that? Did everybody believe they're all in America? They're not all in America. To the four corners of the earth. People have heard it. They've came to it. They're feasting on it. But now then, when we come down into the 50th verse, where it speaks here about, because he's just been talking about when he does come, want to be ready? That's the one that goes. Then he likens the wise servant that shall be given them meat in due season. He's living in the time factor when the carcass is prepared. He knows what the right thing is to say and so forth. And that carries right on through. But goes to show, brothers and sisters, when you read them verses that follows, there is an evil servant in the camp. And he begins to say, my Lord has delayed his coming. Well, I have to say this morning, he never has delayed his coming. He's coming according to the scriptures. I don't care what anybody said. He should come in 88. He should have come in 77. He should have come here. He's coming right on time. It's when we play carnally with something or other. God will not let us in our carnal, mortal state run his program. So therefore, let me say this to you this morning. This evil servant is not out there in the charismatic world. Listen to me. You don't hear anybody out there fussing about, well, Jesus was supposed to come yesterday. You don't even hear that, do you? It's in our kind of people. And you know it. They've left their words. They've left their negative remarks. And this goes to show, by the time that we do come, when that rapture is taking place, the Lord will have come on the scene in a form of spiritual judgment and have eradicated and kicked that person out. Let me say this morning. These verses that I'm reminding you of this morning don't take place in heaven. The only people that's going to leave this earth is those that are going to be changed into immortal flesh. And there's nothing coming out of the ground but what didn't go in the ground ready. So don't ever think, brothers and sisters, that these verses that I'm going to remind you of this morning are going to be taking place in heaven, because nobody is going to be thrown out of heaven. These judgments are down here. It is how the Lord uses his word and his spirit to eradicate, to eliminate, to cast out. Because he's the one that looks at the heart. So with this, When we come to verse 50, I want to remind you. The evil servant shall say, the Lord of that servant shall come in a day. Now the Lord comes. What kind of a coming? It's not his mystical coming when he comes for the church. It's not his visible coming when he comes here with his church. He comes in divine revelation, just as he did in 1963. And if we can't see Christ by divine revelation in his word, then there's something wrong with us. When I sat there on that platform and heard that little man preach those seals, I tell you, brothers and sisters, it made my heart feel invigorated. No, I didn't see Jesus in the visible form, but I saw him in his word. And it let me know, brothers and sisters, we are living close to the end of time. So the evil servant, now he begins to, he's already been talking about the wise servants. He attacks them, runs their character down, runs their image down, but they just kept on preaching away. But after a while, time runs out. He has no more statements to build on. So the Lord, by his Spirit, can come through his word among that same kind of people. And that's exactly, brothers and sisters, the kind of judgment you'll see here. For it was Paul who wrote in, I believe, the Corinthian letter, the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it's to begin with us, what shall be the end of them who live hypocritically? So this kind of a judgment, brother and sister, don't take place in heaven. Because the only kind of people that's going to leave this world are those that's changed and resurrected. And yes, there's a judgment seat of Christ there. But that's a one-time event. And we're not dealing with that. Now then, so verse 50, it's how the Lord eliminates that. It's his separating, getting it out of the body of believers. When we come over to the 25th chapter now, which deals then with the church, the ecclesiastical realm as a whole, this parable starts back here, but it comes on down through time. And when we come into that ear of the shout, that's where the wise begin to go in. You know, brothers and sisters, to me it's not strange. There was no sounding on TVs and radios, come and hear my servant and prophet, because he's bringing you a shout. The minute that God began to use that man with an unusual gift, that went through the church world like a tingling sensation. It began to wake up the heart of people. I've got to see that man. I've got to hear what he has to say. While others went and saw the man and heard him, but didn't see a thing and didn't hear nothing. So I'm saying this morning, when we come down here to the 10th verse, where the wise went to buy, the foolish. In the 9th verse, the wise went in. The wise went in, because brothers and sisters, that's when the wise really begin to come to hear what all about this. And I have to say this morning, there has been people, brother and sister, never did hear Brother Branham audibly nor see him physically. But the minute they heard about them seals, it sparked an interest. So while the wise were going in, the foolish. Now you think I'm wrong. Let me take you back to the 60s. Look what went on in Rome, in the Vatican. Old Pope John, who lived before this Pope, his prayer was that we all might be one. He put that out. But then the Vatican, they had a big meeting over there. And there was absolutely a big Pentecostal man went to that meeting. And I have to say, brothers and sisters, in 63, the wise begin to go in to a revelation of the Word of God that was applicable for that hour. It started something tingling. But at the same time, the gray horse rider began to ride. And he's been riding and galloping all over this world, carrying a message to the foolish virgins. So brothers and sisters, in the 9th verse, the wise went in. But in the 10th verse, it says, and the foolish came. And they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgins. All of this goes to show, brothers and sisters, once God began to separate the bride of Christ from the foolish virgins, and let me say this, also the terror element. Now, brothers and sisters, the terror element is not that bunch standing down there in the saloon that's open this morning. They're that bunch of imitators. They can sing right along with the foolish virgins. They're imitators. You can make anything out of them. They might have religious ideas, but they do not have a revelation of nothing. That's why one day you'll see them in the Baptist church, another in the Methodist church. They're here and they're there. They gallop all over creation. So verse 10, brothers and sisters, is a verse that fits right into this time factor. And it's been going on now for a number of years. I look, brothers and sisters, on a religious world today. Look at the foolish virgin side of the picture. I'm not pointing the finger to run them down and to belittle them. But they give birth to young children. They grow up to be just like them. Nobody is born from his natural birth to be a Christian. He's got to come to a point, brothers and sisters, that he has a feeling in his heart. I have a need. I want God to save my wretched soul. When I look back upon my life, brothers and sisters, before the Lord saved me, I had religious ideas, but it's one thing to have religious ideas and another thing to have salvation. Because salvation gets inside of you. It deals with you. It changes you. It gives you a different concept. It causes you to hunger and thirst. But if you're just a person going through life to get by as cheap as you can have religion. And you can talk about it. But you're not enthused. You're not excited. Nothing stimulates you. So this 10th verse, brothers and sisters, belongs right in that same era time that the shout is going forth. That the Lord spoke to here in the inn that had took his talent, went out and buried it. Don't never think, brothers and sisters, that that kind of a judgment went on in heaven. It did not. It went on down here. Because these are the processes and means how God straightens up his true church, which is the bride, that will be translated from this evil world that we now live in. By the time she reaches that point, there will not be a tear, nor a foolish, unprofitable, or an evil servant in the whole bunch. All of that's part of perfection. Sad part of it is, brothers and sisters, most people just don't know how to read the scriptures. They just listen. Well, it could be. It sounds good. I've heard that so much, brothers and sisters. It's actually almost making light of God's word. But when you really begin to think seriously over the fact, here is three different individuals who fulfill a different kind of a life, and they're rejected. Now you know and I know those three different scriptures that portray three different kinds of people does not take place in heaven. It doesn't. It takes place down here. That's what perfection is all about. and will we all come in unity of the same faith. Now with this in mind, brothers and sisters, we've got to come to the hour of time when the church will have known all of these scriptures that pertains to her earthly existence as she lives, progresses, learns, getting closer and closer and closer. She'll have all these scriptures in her mind. Her life has been gauged by the Lord according to them. She finds that they as an individual cannot be shook. They're moving toward the hour of time then when there will be that last thing that is done. And that's when that seventh seal is broke. Now here's where we're going to come to hair pulling. I stand been broke, Brother Jackson. Then you tell me what it is. Because when I heard Brother Branham say it, it's something or other pertaining to the nearness and the point or the time of the coming of Christ for his bride. Don't never think, brothers and sisters, that God is going to let you or me know 35 years ahead of time when he's coming. If we did, we'd make chaos out of it. It's just like after the seals was preached. And I went into Brownlow Townsend's barbershop. There he sits back there. And one of the young men then that took care of the tapes, he was in the barber chair. I went in too to get a haircut. And from the barber chair, this young man looked down at me. Well, it won't be long now, will it, Brother Jackson? I said, no, don't look that way. He said, you know, the way I look at it, I feel like I've got enough now to take care of me now until Jesus comes. Without having to do anything. Well, I never did think that. Because I heard Brother Branham say, no matter if you knew he was coming tomorrow, go, if you raise taters, plant taters today. If you're a carpenter, if you knew he was coming tonight, you go ahead and build today. Keep your mind busy and occupied. It's when you sit down. That's when the devil gets in there and plants out a lot of ideas that don't amount to a dime. And you know what? That young man that was a young man then, he's dead now. He didn't live to see the coming of Christ. Because you know why? Look at all these young ones. Look at all these young ones sitting here. I'm glad. Because in my mind, I know that God's seen. There's others yet he wants, and he's going to come precisely right on time when they're here and they can hear and they've taken their part. And I will say, brothers and sisters, one of these days, when this element of wise virgins have absolutely reached the point that when they look back, they see time, they see how God has dealt with them, what he has done for them, what he has put inside of them, how it has changed their mind and their attitude, how they see themselves in the Word of God, they're going to be waiting for that revelation of that seventh seal. And brothers and sisters, that's saved for the bride of Christ. Now let me say this morning. The seventh seal is not for the foolish virgins. The fourth seal is the last fourth seal that deals with the salvation. Because we are living under the fourth seal. I'd hate to think, brothers and sisters, that we done went back to the lion. That was the first one. Then the next one was the ox. Then was the man. That's through the long reformation period. Now we live under the eagle spirit. And that's why, brothers and sisters, he don't intend to leave the bride here in ignorance. Because truly, brothers and sisters, if we're a little eagle, our ears is open. I want to hear what that eagle has to say. I want to be a part of that. And then, brothers and sisters, that sixth seal was absolutely all for the tribulation, whatever goes on there, and Christ comes under the consummation of it. Now then, but the seventh seal will bring an understanding and a revelation of the coming of Christ to his church, the bride that's ready. And brothers and sisters, well, Brother Jackson, does that mean she will go in 2 days? Don't look at it that way. Now, if you're one of them that believes they're all going to be gathered together in one spot, go ahead and preach it that way. But the bride of Christ that I'm talking about is not all going to be gathered together in one spot. Because she don't need no bus, no jet airplane, or no rocket. Because brother, here is a shout. But right here when that seventh seal is broken, that's going to be the revelation and the voice of the archangel. And then the trump of God, brothers and sisters, is going to bring Christ coming that will raise the dead. All right. When that dead in Christ shall rise, listen carefully, that's going to cover every age right back to the apostolic hour. James was the first one martyred, wasn't he? Then we find, from then on, martyrdom started. These were people destined to be bride saints. Amen. But now, brothers and sisters, follow my line of thought. As we come through the first age, there was many of those godly, righteous, Holy Ghost-filled saints that lived in certain areas of the then gospel era. Many of them were martyred. But there was others that died a natural death. They are part of the bride also. But then, brothers and sisters, we have to believe that there was others that was martyred. Maybe in 3 or 4 days after they had surrendered and give their hearts to God. They had not lived long enough to cultivate their outlook toward talents and things. Keep in mind, just remember this in your mind, they will not be in the bride, but they are people that's going to be robed in white robes. I've got a reason for saying this. Because did you know, brothers and sisters, when the dead in Christ shall rise, according to Paul's revelation, is he just talking about those that died a natural death? Or isn't he talking about some of them that was martyred? It's both. But keep in mind, all through them same periods, there was people that probably heard the gospel, but didn't live too long right after that. Therefore, they didn't have time to live and to show their talents and to produce their fruitful life. I want to take you back, brothers and sisters, to the thief on the cross. Keep in mind, when Jesus died on the cross, there was 2 thieves, one on the right hand, one on the left hand. That one over there, he was a great big loud mouth character. He was just yakking his head off. Looked over here at this other thief. Why don't you say something too? But you know, hanging there on the cross and watching this man in the middle, that thief began to think. Here they're condemning and absolutely crucifying, executing an innocent man. Instead of him opening his mouth and cursing, he looked at him and said, "Master, remember me when you come in your kingdom." Now, brothers and sisters, listen carefully. That thief was not martyred. He was executed for being a thief. But it goes to show, in that state, he had never thought about anything until he was there on the cross. Remember me when you come in your kingdom. And Jesus said to him, this day thou shalt be with me in paradise. That don't mean he's going to be in the bride. But it does mean he will be in that category that will come up wearing white robes. The bride of Christ, listen, wears fine linen. There's a difference. And I didn't know that. What do you do now? The 19th chapter of Revelation. After then the bride has been taken up here. John then was made to see her in heaven. And she was clothed in fine linen. There's a difference between fine linen and white robes. I will take you back to the 16th chapter of Exodus. When Moses told the children of Israel how to build the tabernacle and the outer court and everything. In that tent where this Ark of the Covenant was set, that little room in there was absolutely to be clothed off with fine linen. Fine linen. That means where the dwelling of God is at. And that's why, brothers and sisters, when the true church started on the day of Pentecost, she was an element of people filled with that Holy Spirit. And that Shekinah glory that was in that little room behind curtains of fine linen is now dwelling in here. And she's to be clothed in the most beautiful revelation that's to make up the fiber of the garment. That's why. Now if you want to go with me this morning. Go with me to the book of Revelations. We come right into that chapter, in the 6th chapter. These first verses that cover these beasts. To the gray horse, but there's the fourth beast in heaven that had the face of the eagle. I'll never forget when Brother Branham brought this revelation out of this fifth seal. I've told it many times before. Some people from Chicago had come down. They was already in the area for this whole week of meetings. And they come down home to visit us that day. And I was asked, Brother Jackson, do you think it's possible for a Jew to ever be saved, having not confessed and believed in the Lord Jesus Christ? I said no. I just said no. He's got to be saved through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. But when I come to the tabernacle that night, and there I was sitting right close to the front. And that little man come out there. And then he come to the time when he read this. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar. Now notice, under the altar. That's a place where you offer sacrifice. The souls of them that were slain for the word of God here. And for the testimony which they held. Nothing is said about Jesus Christ at all. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? How long? Well, notice what was done. They weren't even answered. And white robes were given unto every one of them, not fine linen. White robes to every one of them. And it was said unto them that they should rest yet a little season until their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. And when Brother Branham came along and said, that's them Jews there in the Holy Ghost. Now, he could have said on back down to the Spanish Inquisition, too. Just because he didn't specialize in the Spanish Inquisition, God would be an unjust God. between that 12th and 13th century, when that Catholic system in Spain executed Jews. I've got a book that has told me the terrible picture. Put them on a table, strap their hands and their feet with ropes that goes to a winch. Have great big old burly men turning the crank. And the point of it is to pull every joint out of socket. And keep on pulling until you scream your head off. And you either deny or else you die. Others, now you may not like what I'm going to tell you, but I've read it. Others, they hook two oxen to their feet. And they sharpen a post and bury it partly in the ground. And they start to sharpen in that post up the rectum of the victim. And then they whip the oxen and pull the body of that person down on that post and then stick the post in the ground and let you hang there and die. I don't like to tell things like this, brother and sister, but I know sometimes people can just get so numb and set. And I have to say, and I've got another book at home, those that are ready to die for the sake of the emperor. Even in the second century, when Christians were being massacred, slaughtered, and fed to the animals, Jews was brought into the same arenas. Little children. So my point is, brothers and sisters, keep in mind, it's the 20th century, and we're right over here in 1963. But this that he said was fulfilled in 1939 to 45, just 18 years back from that. That's my generation. I'm knowledgeable of it. And then when it was said to them, rest a little season, tell your fellow brethren and servants should be killed as you are. That puts them right over here. Now, why do I bring this in about these Jews? Are we going to say them that they were martyred on their testimony in the commandments of God and the testimony they held? Are we not going to allow any old Jew to die of heart attack? I hope we don't become so narrow-minded. How many are listening to me? Because after all, brothers and sisters, I'm going to read about three different resurrections categories. And are we going to wind up saying, well, they all got to be martyred? Well, then what happens to those that die natural death? Ain't there no place for them? Sure there is. God's merciful and gracious. But look at these Jews. 19 to 39 to 45, 6 million. Does that mean they're all saints? No. Some of them, when them old Hitler machine guns, and were fallen. Probably some of them were so wicked, cursing. If there was a God, I've even heard him say it. If there's a God, why did he allow us to suffer so much? So my point is, when Brother Branham looked at that and God gave him the divine revelation, that's pointed to the souls of them under the altar. Notice the position. And they're crying, how Lord, long, O Lord. White robes, that's eternal life. But it is not fine linen, is it? All right. Then the next thing, brothers and sisters, John sees the seventh chapter come into the setting. And he saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth. And them four corners is right in where the Rio Fates River is at. And the angels crying out, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any trees. And I saw another angel ascending from the east. And I'll have to say, brothers and sisters, somewhere, as God brings us in close to this week of this time, and he finishes, brothers and sisters, his revelation to us to make us ready. And Revelation's 10th chapter is hanging right over this, where Jesus is seen in his angelic form with one foot on the land and on the sea. The minute he lifts up his voice, that time should be no more, that ends it for you and me. He's seen then, brothers and sisters, in Revelation chapter 12, standing on the river. That puts you right. That's when the angel goes. Listen now. So he heard the number of the Jews that was to be sealed. When are they to be sealed? He heard the number, 144,000. Notice the word contents. And he heard the number of them which were sealed. That puts John right here. Not on earth, but in the spirit world. Because when he was taken up, he was projected into the future tense to see the developments of things for our day. Now watch. The 9th verse. After this, I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number of all nations, and kindreds, and peoples, and tongues stood before this. Now they stood before the throne. They're not under the altar. Let's notice the position in heaven. They're standing before the throne. And before the Lamb. Clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. Who are these, Brother Jackson? Your charismatic world will say, well, that's the bride of Christ. It's not the bride of Christ. It's all of those other people, brothers and sisters, that the grace of God has saved down through time. Some of them were martyred. Some died of natural death. And in the 13th century in Europe, when the Black Plague hit, and some of the village was almost wiped out, they were not martyred in the sense of execution. They died because of diseases. And I've just read in the history the other day, even in Norway, there's two little villages, Hurdal and Berdal. I mean, not Berdal. Mandal. One man was left alive in the village named after him. And one woman was left alive in the village that was named Hurdal. All in that period of time. Are we going to say then, are these people martyred? No. They've died because of diseases. If any woman were Christians. And that's why I say sometimes, brothers and sisters, people just go through, they go skipping through school and they read at history, but they don't even read it at all. They read just enough to pass. But I'm thankful to God, brothers and sisters, there's some things in history that's important to you if you're going to bring it into the line with the scriptures of God's word. Now notice this multitude. Notice where they're from. Out of every nation, tongues, and kindred. Who are all of these? They're not the bride. But they're absolutely people that's been saved in the first age, second age, third age, fourth age, fifth age, sixth age. Coming down through here. Are you listening to me? Some did die a martyr's death. But some died in this era as foolish virgins. Right. Now that I've put that thought, If you'll take what you read in Revelation 19, and there's the bride in heaven. She was clothed in fine linen. She represents that redeemed element of beings that have been chosen and taken out of all nations. Not at once, but in the periods of time that God has dealt in that nation. And at the same time he was dealing with his elected ones, the bride, you had this other category. They didn't live long. Some of them were martyred. Some of them died a natural death. And I have to say, that's the ones that's still standing before the throne. I've heard the charismatics say, well, we can prove by the Bible that there's no such thing as the church to be raptured before tribulation. Well, brothers and sisters, that's where they're reading the scriptures from. When you read the 19th chapter with brothers and sisters, it takes place right here. That puts the bride in heaven. She then goes to then the supper in heaven. And here she is on white horses coming back with him. But all of these other saints that was not resurrected then, but they had white robes, and it goes to show, and they washed them and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Because it says down here in the 14th verse, because they have came out of great tribulation. Not necessarily this tribulation, but the Spanish Inquisition. And when you start reading the histories, brothers and sisters, and now that brings me to this point, and I will close. Here is our institutions of learning today trying to instill in our youth that we've got untold multitudes of Islamic people here. They're peaceful. They're nice people. Well, then why won't they stand and salute the flag then of America? I'm going to get next to you in a minute, brothers and sisters. We've let that kind of stuff come in here, claiming something to get in here. But then, brothers and sisters, when something does happen to our nation as a tragedy, as 9-1-1 was, and then people begin to salute the flag or sing about how great is God and such like, them same kind of people, they want to, well, I don't like this. This makes me feel nervous. Well, it ought to make you feel nervous. They have no right to be here if me saluting the flag offends them. And I know this is going out into other nations. And if you're hooked on in Saudi Arabia, I hope you hear me. Amen. Don't come to America if you can't salute our flag. Because you won't let me come over there. In 1990, you wouldn't even let our troops come over there. And then we come along later, pass out Bibles. That was a law. Well, then for God's sake, stay out of America. Unless you could come here to be an American. Don't come here to eat the icing off the cake. I saw this ad last night. It's an advertisement. 36 million Americans are living below the poverty line. Well, the government, why are you giving welfare and stuff to these immigrants coming in here, but you let your own constituents starve and live below the poverty line? What a hypocritical spirit this is in America. Shame on politicians. You're not going to change the world. You just think you are. My Bible tells me when this world is changed and made a better place to live in, Jesus Christ is coming. And Muhammad's not coming. Buddha's not coming. Hindu's not coming. Shinto's not coming. Jains and Sikhs, they're not coming. But Jesus Christ is. I've said enough until tonight. All right, brother. Come right on. I'm an American. I remember, brothers and sisters, when I was a child, Orientals came here and worked on our railroads. Irish came here and worked on our railroads. Chinese came here and worked on our railroads. Then went back and became laundrymen and stuff. But it was all Americans. But now in the last 40 years, they come in here like a bunch of mice. And if the FBI and the CIA and the ATF and all the rest wants to listen to that, that's help yourself. One of these days they're going to set your house on fire. They're going to burn your bed out from under you. And then you'll remember what we've said. God bless you today, brother.
We weren't clapping because he said he is through. We was clapping because we enjoyed truth. Want you to know that.
Thank you, brother.
Amen. They'll let the musicians come. Going to be a baptism. I don't know how many. Just follow Brother Bud there, if you would, please. Because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone, 'cause I know he holds the future, and life is worth living just because he lives. Because he lives. You have a need this morning. Come on. Because he lives, all fear is gone. 'Cause I know holds the future, and life is worth living just because he lives. Aren't you glad that you're a little eagle this morning sitting at the table? Brother Bud made the statement the other night. He said, the great eagle, the big eagle, don't just bring and just throw a fish into the little ones, but it goes in there, and I've seen this also, comes in there and pulls it off piece by piece, and gives to the little eaglets. Aren't you glad that that great eagle didn't just throw it to you, but that he has sent servants to be able to break it off and give each one a bite-sized piece? We thank the Lord.
Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to me thy great salvation. So rich and free. Oh, thank you, Lord, for saving my soul.
so rich and free. Oh, thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to me thy great salvation, so rich and free.
Amen. About a month ago, Ethan and I, we was up Patoka, and I seen this, seen an eagle. And we just stopped there, and I began to give him a little lesson on the eagle age and what we were. And as we watched it, it just kept soaring. It was catching a thermal, and it just go higher and higher and higher till it was almost out of sight. And I was thinking of that today, how I just feel like I'm getting higher and higher in what he has for me, and I appreciate the Lord. Amen. One of these days, we're just going to probably don't have a sight. How great it is to serve a living God, who knows each breath I take and every step I trod. How great it is to serve a God that's real, who sees my every tear, and he knows just how I feel. How great it is to serve a living God, who knows each breath I take and every step I trod. How great it is serve a God that's real, who sees my every tear, and he knows just how I feel. How great it is to serve a living God, and every step I trod. How great it is to serve a God that's real, who sees my every tear, and he knows just how I feel.